بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعه وله وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد, we continue with the رياض الصالحين and we still with the long hadith of جبريل عليه السلام. The hadith when جبريل عليه السلام came to رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم to teach the صحابة the affairs of their deen as رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم told them. So the whole point of the hadith is الله عز وجل sending جبريل عليه السلام to have this conversation with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam to teach al-umma, not only the sahaba sitting, to teach all the umma the affairs of their deen. هذا جبريل أتاكم يعلمكم دينكم. This is جبريل who came to teach you your deen. So keep that in mind when we are studying this hadith. So we are learning the deen through the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. And we are in the area of zakah. After Jibril alayhi salam comes to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell me about Islam. He tell him about the shahada, that you do the shahada, shahadu an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammad Rasulullah. Then you do the salah and then you do the zakah. Zakah. So the zakah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said it goes to 8 categories. The zakah goes to 8 categories. First the zakah has to be zakah has to be given from the rich to the poor. Subhanallah, zakah has to be given from the rich to the poor, and it is the duty of the Muslim when they reach the nisab or the zakatable money, and they maintain it for 1 year. So they reach the zakah or the zakatable minimum, and it continues for 1 whole year. And the zakah according to gold, it is 85 grams of gold. 85 grams of gold. And from silver, 595 grams. Now you make the calculation, inshallah, because the gold keeps going up. So if somebody have worth of 85 grams of gold or 595 grams of silver, and they maintain this minimum for 1 whole year, it does not go below that, yeah. It is maintained for 1 whole year, then at the end of the year they see what they have, that or more, and they give 2.5% on whatever they have. That's the simple, yani, simplistic view. We're not going to open a fiqh session today for that, but it is the simplest view. Now if you calculate the zakah according to the weight of gold, your nisab is going to be higher and the minimum is going to be higher. But if you calculate it according to silver, your nisab will be lower. For the first one is more benefit to the one who gives the zakah, because they will not give the zakah until they reach that higher minimum. If you calculate according to the silver, more benefit to the poor, because everybody who have the minimum will give more zakah. I mean, it comes at the end of the same, because you know, if someone reaches the gold, they will give a certain amount. But if somebody calculates with the silver, it will be smaller amounts of the zakah and so on. Yani. So we don't want to confuse you now, but this is the one who gives. there is zakah also in the animals, like camels, cows, sheep, and all of that. There is zakah on stocks, and the zakah on the things that you sell. The zakah on the profit, if you're renting a house and you do, you know, getting a profit and all of that. The sheep, for example, every time a person has 40, not less than 40, 40, then he gives one sheep until it comes to, after that, 121, then he gives two sheep. So there is different calculations for different things, right? So the sheep, for the camels, for the, how old is the camel, how old is the sheep? It's a very accurate system, yani, right? So that's for the zakah. Also, when a person is planting things, do they have it with the rainwater or with the river water, or they have to put like machines and stuff like that? Each calculation of the zakah is different. Zakah for treasure troves, like, you know, somebody found gold or silver or something like that in their backyard, or in Texas they find oil, what do they do? Yeah, sahih, the zakah is alright, so then masarif al-zakah, whom we give the zakah. I'm just going fast here, you know, just a general idea about zakah. الله عز وجل mentioned that in سورة التوبة. الله mentioned that in سورة التوبة أنه الصدقات للفقراء والمساكين والعاملين عليها والمؤلفة قلوبهم وفي الرقاب والغارمين وفي سبيل الله وابن السبيل. Eight categories. I told you last time, صدقات, the word صدقة is mentioned in the Quran. It means zakat, it means charity. Okay, the zakah is mentioned alone by itself. So they are not mentioned in the same ayah. Remember the rule? If they are mentioned different, they mean each other. Remember that? Yeah, خذ من أموالهم صدقة تطهرهم وتزكيهم بها. Take from their money amount, يعني that it will purify them and all that. It can be the charity, it can be the duty. إنما الصدقات للفقراء والمساكين. It means here the زكاة. The فرض زكاة. أقيموا الصلاة وآتوا الزكاة. It is the زكاة, right? So, and so on. يعني. So, الفقراء والمساكين are the people who cannot find their, you know, their income is different. It's not enough to meet their minimum needs. Minimum needs. It's not someone making like few thousand dollars every month and really they want to live in a big house and have like a nice car and money is not enough, give me from zakah. It does not work like that. Or someone who have like lots of gold and they don't want to sell it but they want to get the zakah. It does not work like that either. And if someone have money that can liquidate, they should liquidate it and you know, have money to survive. The whole idea, my brothers and sisters, that money of the zakah, it is not like a, how should I say it? It's not like an opportunity. And don't treat it like an opportunity. Opportunity, you know, like an opportunity. So let me take as much as I can for as long as I can. This mentality is not good. And also, when you are giving the zakah, oh, I'm doing the community a favor. That mentality is not good either. Right? So this both ways are no good. So someone giving the zakah, you are helping yourself, clearing your money, purifying your heart. That's what it is. You're supposed to be eager to give it out. You are helping yourself before you are helping anyone else. If you don't do that, you are doomed. If you are rich and you are supposed to give the zakah, but you are not giving it, this is a problem. Okay? Sayyidina Abu Bakr fought people for that. You know, they didn't want to give the zakah. So when you are giving the zakah, you are helping yourself more than the person who receive it. Should be happy about it. Should be eager to do it. Now when you're receiving the zakah, when a person is receiving the zakah, it's not like, oh, an opportunity, let me take as much as I can, as long as I can. No. Right? This is just to help you get over your issue, and you should be eager to get over your issue as soon as possible. And you're supposed to be eager to give zakah, not to receive zakah. This is... It's not good to stay in the receiving end while you can get out of it. I hope that is very... And the zakah also supposed to suffice the person, get them out of their issue and get them up and running on their feet. That's the whole point of zakah is that. It is not like a welfare kind of continuous, you know, just you take the zakah, I give the zakah, everybody's happy, let's do it. It's not like that. All right? It's not like that. You know, staying in the receiving end of the zakah is supposed to be something that pushing you to become a better person. And in the giving end of the zakah is supposed to be like, I give as much as I can, more and more, so this is not there anymore. So each one is trying to solve the issue from their end, and that's how the community grows, and that's how the need is over. So, faqir and miskin. Some of the ulama made the difference between al-faqir and miskin. Faqir does not have the food of their day. يعني. That's faqir. Miskin means their income is not enough for meeting their meeting their minimum need. And there is a hadith for Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, miskin من ترده التمرته والتمرتين. يعني. The miskin is not like the one that you give one date or two dates and they go. That's faqir, right? طبعا, every language have their own reference. We're saying that faqir and miskin in Arabic, if you go in detail, both mean the same generally, but if they are together in one ayah, إنما الصدقات للفقراء وال, that means there are two different categories, because there are two different categories, because they are mentioned in the same ayah. But if it is in general, the ayah has faqir means faqir and miskin, ayah has miskin means faqir and miskin. But when the faqir and miskin mentioned in the same ayah means faqir is one thing and miskin is one thing. So he gives zakah to the person who does not have anything, homeless, does not have food. He gives zakah to that. And also gives zakah to someone who has shelter, who eats every day, but they have duties that they cannot fulfill because they're right. فقراء والمساكين أو العاملين عليها who are العاملون عليها the ones who are appointed to collect the zakah and give the zakah because there are people their duty is to collect the zakah especially in a bigger state or a bigger community they collect the zakah and then they give the zakah to others so those can have a share from the zakah according to what is agreed on to take the zakah and deliver it so monthly salary or their you know things like that and in our time organizations that collected the zakah from people and deliver it and go through hardships and go through danger things and all that they can take the from that so when a relief organization or something like they take you have to understand that this is the right according to the book of Allah and the Sunnah otherwise how it's going to happen you know how it's going to happen you just give the money and they take all the troubles to deliver it so this is something also should be appreciated as well والمؤلفة قلوبهم المؤلفة قلوبهم someone new Muslim you know converted accepted Islam and they need help and this is something also the community need to be aware of see it's all about strategic planning because you know fortunately sometimes I'm included as well we overwhelm ourselves with many good things good not bad huh? good things and then we get frustrated we burn out okay so this is an issue so you have lots of money coming but you have lots of people asking okay then you know you give and then you end up you don't have anything in the bucket and still people asking right and now you get caught in the issue how can I make prioritize this how do I give everyone small amount or I give someone big amount or what should I do okay so that needs strategic planning of a system that everybody is part of it we should reach to that yani when it comes to the zakah in the community we should think like a bigger Muslim community not only north or Houston or no the bigger and people try that and it's very hard in America by the way in the west because you are not under one rule everybody here is in their own you know I like to pray at that masjid you cannot tell me to pray in the other masjid I want to give zakah and this you cannot tell me where to give the zakah so it ends up like that right but if we have a bigger pool then it becomes an issue no issue in giving the zakah so people collaborate in the zakah this is one system and that system is not like based on political leadership or things this organization or that organization this center or that center no there is a pool of zakah everybody this is where the zakah money goes and then there is you know this organization handle this organization handle that and the zakah should be There should be a system, yeah, and I'm sure computer people can come up with something that prioritize that. It's doable, though. So, need some strategic planning. Otherwise, you will find everybody's asking. So, new Muslims accepted Islam. They're out of a job, or their family kicked them out from their place, whatever reason, yeah, right? So, there is some issues that you need to help. So, people become Muslims, and Subhanallah, if we. Care, and if we are a good community, we'll make a class for them, right? There are many communities who don't even make that, and you don't hear about them again. You know, we don't know where are they, who are they, you know. You checking on them or not, okay? So they accept Islam and takbir and all the good, nice things, alhamdulillah, and hugs and kisses and all that, that's good. Then after that, we don't know. They're married or not married, they need to get married or not. They have children or not, they have issues with divorce or not, you know, they have home or not, okay? And they have things like that. So there are issues. And then, you know, but there are issues. They need counseling or not, they need education or not, they need to learn Salah or not. I know some Muslims that they've been Muslims for 3 and 4 years, and until now they don't know how to read Surah Al-Fatiha in the Salah. Whose responsibility is that, you think? I can bring him here if you want. So it's not like, you know, like I'm exaggerating or anything. No, I can bring them here and you test them. Somebody accepted Islam in this masjid. Okay? And they take, I'm sorry, if I, please, you know, don't feel like I'm putting anybody in this spot, but this is a truth here. Yeah, I haven't been here long, but those are issues we don't focus on, you know? But we can focus on this and that, and we play it like this, but those are issues. Those are real issues. 3-4 years, and they don't know whether to say Subhana Rabbiyal A'la when they are in the ruku' or in the sujood. Do you think this is a small issue? If you think it's a small issue, I'll go on. I'll just go on in the class. It's not a small issue. It's not, wallah, a small issue. This is the salah of someone who trusted us as a community and came and said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna. And you are my brothers and sisters. And this is my deen. This is, I'm going to be standing in front of Allah in Yawm al Qiyamah. I trust you with it and what we do. Silence, exactly. So this is the whole point, right? So inshallah we'll start a class here and we'll do this. We will do this and we need your support. Right? You need your support. It's not only to give somebody to go buy like a meal from there. No, this needs to be taken care of. And they need to be taken care of good. Alright? It's very hard when I get a call from a revert sister and they said, you know, you go into zakat and they make me feel like, you know, I'm begging and I'm doing this and I'm that and I just need $500 to get something, and I go and the system and there's no system. I'm not accusing anybody, but I'm just telling you real cases. So I have to go out of the way and I have to go ask somebody and get the cash from somebody and give it to the sister to go and pay. And sometimes I will do it myself to you know, because they said I'm not just taking the money to get used to abuse the community or anything like that. I'm actually doing the money for that reason. Please, you go pay it. They just tell you that it's not like they are abusing the system or anything like that. It's an actual need, right? It's an actual need, and I find it important when somebody like that, I go out of my home and I go for that reason. It's worth it. But if they call somebody and they said, you know, I want the zakah, and then somebody said, you come tomorrow, that's an issue for me. For me, it's an issue. I'm just telling you, and you know, so it is like until tomorrow, that person can leave the religion until tomorrow morning. It can, and it happened. So it's المؤلفة قلوبهم, Allah Azza wa Jal put it as one of the recipients of zakah in al-book, in al-Qur'an, يعني, the book, al-Qur'an, right? So that means it's important. Also مؤلفة قلوبهم, if someone who is about to, and you know, money can help, and Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did that, actually. Give people who are not Muslims from the zakah money and from the money of the spoils of war and all of that, you just give them, and they give them a big share also. Okay, so these people can become Muslims as well. So والمؤلفة قلوبهم وفي الرقاب, طبعا this is can, it was slavery, but now in our time they call it what, the prisoner of war, captives, prisoner of war also is part. So the ulama said that there are three parts under في الرقاب. في الرقاب, رقاب يعني neck, رقبة neck. في الرقاب means, you know, slaves, because you know slaves they used to have that, you know, thing collar here. Islam came to change that. They call him رقبة, means, you know, freeing that neck of that person from, you know, figurative speech. So في الرقاب means those. So the three. One is to buy a slave and free. Okay, so a person owned a slave, said, how much is a slave? 1,000 dinar. Here is 1,000 dinar. Ya Habibi, anta hurr liwajh Allah. You see? That is a في الرقاب. So you can do that from zakah money. Yeah, so somebody have the zakah. Okay, I have this zakah here. This zakah can buy 3 slaves, 4 slaves. Go ahead. Okay? That is one. The other, there was another system, is called al-mukatab. Mukatab means yaktub, يعني. So the person comes to his slave and said, you know what, here is a contract between me and you. If you get me 50,000 dinar or 3,000 dinar or whatever money, I free you. So go work go work 5 hours a day or 6 hours a day. You do work. You save your money. I don't want it. But once you collect for me this much, you're free. Okay, so now he's stuck. So I have zakah, I can give him to free himself. That's another way of doing it. And the third way, as I said, the prisoner of war are, you know, giving money, so the people are imprisoned with the enemies, and then you say, okay, I'm gonna give this much money fidya, and we'll give it. And Rasulullah did that. So when they captured people from Mecca, Quraysh said, you know, they pay the money, you release them. Okay, so it is like that. Wal-gharimeen, those who are in debt, that they cannot pay. So somebody who have, mashallah, $1 million house, and they paying every month, so do not come saying, oh, I'm in debt, please pay my debt, right? No. Al-gharim, يعني المدينة الذي لا يستطيع الوفاء. He is not able to fulfill the debt, right? To fulfill the debt. So someone, the debt is due, and then you help them from the zakah to give it. And there's lots of details under that. What kind of debt? Is it halal or haram? Is it, you know, there are issues with this one. It's not like somebody going gambling and then, you know, we're going to pay their debt every time they are in debt, you know. It's not like that. There is gharimeen, a lot of gharimeen everywhere. Yeah, so my advice is like always, and you can take it or leave it, yeah, it's up to you. It's always individual issues will have lots of flaws, right? Organization, maybe there is flaws, but less, okay? Because they're dealing with a bigger amount and they focus on certain things, whether it is they paying the debts or they helping the relief work or they're doing this or doing that. So at least to have a clear vision where your money is going, right? I'm a proponent of that. I want organizations really to handle this well in the West. And the only way they handle it well, if we give more money toward that. Because now they're gonna make studies, they are gonna hire good people, they are gonna become better, they're gonna focus on what they are good at. And then me and you, it becomes easy, right? You want your money to go this one. Some people focus on the local issues. Some people focus on international issues. Some people focus on, you know, families. Some people focus on refugees or go over there. You know, this is good. It's a good thing. So, you know, at least it becomes clear. So the more we give zakah to these organizations, the more, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, they become better, right? Because part of that zakah will go to make them become better in what they do. So part of the zakah, al-amilin alayha, right? So they can invest part of the zakah to better themselves, have studies, have equipment, have people. This is better. Okay, so inshallah, yani, this is good. So give the zakah. So my advice is to always trust an organization with that, but the organization also from their side, they have to be on top of it, not haphazard. They have to really have a defined way of looking at things, how you get and how you give. It's amana. It's an amana from the community. وفي سبيل الله, that's subhanallah where يعني, the big issue comes, right? في سبيل الله, part of the ulama said this is only for the jihad, for the army, for the people who defend, right, the state. And the other said في سبيل الله is much bigger than that. And under في سبيل الله comes more interpretations, especially in our time, contemporary now. Do you give to the masajid or not? Do you give Islamic schools or not? Islamic universities or not? You know, making presentations in the masjid, giving da'wah to people, it's an issue and a vaster than we think. So it is, and we'll leave that to our ulama to give the fatawa in it. And subhanAllah, if you want more details, go to the Amja website, amjaonline.org, and you will find the zakah in our contemporary times. You'll find questions coming every day. And so, خلنا خلص إن شاء الله, after we finish. So, the zakah is to be given to different causes, because under fi sabilillah it is like you are serving the cause of Allah. It is not for any personal benefits or anything like that. So it's not up to a lay person to interpret, though. So you have to really be careful. It's not like, oh, fi sabilillah, this is fi sabilillah, I'm going to give the zakah. Be careful before you do that. So you have to ask someone with knowledge to tell you whether this way is right or not. وابن السبيل وابن السبيل is the one who's traveling but they lost everything or they cannot reach safe. So وابن السبيل. Those are eight categories to receive the zakah, and this is the third pillar of al-Islam. Inshallah, I'm going to take questions after I finish in a few minutes, inshallah. So save your questions. The fourth pillar of Islam is Sawm Ramadan. MashaAllah, you know that Ramadan is in about 5 months coming? Can you believe that? SubhanAllah, we're just like, felt like last week, you know, doing Taraweeh and all that. But that's time, right? The time, may Allah Azza wa Jalla give barakah in our time. So Shahr Ramadan, it is a month between Sha'ban and the Shawwal. Sha'ban comes before month number 8 and Shawwal month number 10 in the lunar month, يعني, lunar calendar. So the month of Ramadan, يعني, they say that they called it Ramadan from Ramda. Ramda, يعني, the hot sand when it is hot. So when they were naming the month, all times, يعني, it coincided that it was the first Ramadan was like in very hot time, so they call it Ramadan because of that. يعني. That's one interpretation. Allahu A'lam if it is true or not. الرسول صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم said whoever fast Ramadan out of faith and hoping in Allah's reward and trusting Allah's reward, Allah عز وجل will wipe out all your sins. وفر لهم ما تقدم من ذنب. So imagine every Ramadan, if it is done properly with the right niyyah, with the right hope in Allah's reward, all your sin erased, subhanAllah. So that's why it's very important to have that niyyah before the month of Ramadan. Whoever do qiyam in Ramadan, get the same reward. Whoever do qiyam of Laylat al-Qadr, get the same reward. So you get it three times. You get three opportunities in Ramadan for all your previous sins to be forgiven. Okay? Qiyam, qiyam, and Laylat al-Qadr. So fasting of every day. Qiyam means prayer, long night prayer every night. And Laylat al-Qadr, the last 10. So this is, subhanAllah, يعني, great chance, great opportunity, times three. If you miss one, you have one, or if you get all three, you make sure that بإذن الله all forgiven. طبعا, I wanted to emphasize on one thing here. Whenever you have a hadith or a saying about an act that all the sins would be forgiven, it means not the major sins, okay? And not the sins that a person is insisting on. So this, just keep that in the mind, right? So major sin, it needs a specific tawbah, tawbah khassa. يعني you have to make the two rak'ah prayer, ask Allah Azza wa Jalla for forgiveness. Of course, the person had to stop the sin, regret the sin, not to do the sin again. And if it involves someone, that they have to give the right. Okay? So that's one section by itself. So it's not like, you know, from Ramadan to Ramadan, erasing from Umrah to Umrah, from Jum'ah to Jum'ah. This is the minor stuff. Minor sins, right? So, yeah. The month of Ramadan, also the month that Allah Azza Jal revealed the Quran, and is the only month in the mentioned in the Quran. يعني Muharram is not mentioned in the Quran, Safar is not mentioned in the Quran, Rabi' is not mentioned in the Quran, Zulhijjah, Zulqa'da, only Ramadan. And it is the month of the Quran. And it is a pillar of Islam. يعني people have to believe that there is, Muslim has to believe that there is a pillar called fasting Ramadan. Step number one, okay? Step number two, to fast it. And if somebody believes it's Ramadan, but they are not fasting, they are disobedient. But if somebody disbelieves in Ramadan, they are kafir. So it's kind of like, yeah, so I have to know that. Muslim, to fast. Baligh, reached puberty. Aqil, سيدني يعني سنتي قادر able مقيم resident قادر يعني physically able مقيم means resident سالما من الموانع يعني does not have any defect or anything like that prevents them from fasting. So six conditions for a person to have Ramadan as fard on them. If a person is sick, terminally ill, they feed one miskin for every day. Terminal ill, diabetes or cancer or something, that they cannot fast. old age, same thing. Majnoon, person majnoon does not have their mind. Or under anesthesia, or yani they are a coma. Sanity here, it does not mean majnoon, only a crazy person yani running around, right? So same thing. So someone in a coma, induced coma or actual coma, you cannot, you know, tell them to fast. Or if they yani come up and go back again or something like that. Is the microphone okay, or I'm thinking? Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah, it's always the case, but that's all right. So if he's younger than reaching the age of puberty, then the fasting is not a must on them. But should we train them or not?
Yes.
Yes. And subhanAllah, yani, from experience, and I'm sure you know that if you have kids, shukran. You have kids, you will find that who start training their children when they are young to fast, they don't have problem when they become teenagers and elders. Those who did not do that becomes tough for the children. So the children might dislike it, but they'll thank you later on. If you're still around, they'll thank you later on. But if you don't, and you think about, oh, children, let them, oh, come on, Sheikh, it's all right, you know, they're tough, it's tough on them and all that. Yeah, you can be, you can play the nice father or nice mother now, but you're gonna cry later. And those cases are there, you know. I'm sure you are not exaggerating, but it's, you know, we have people who come, their children 16, 17, 18, and they say, Sheikh, they cannot fast the whole Ramadan. I said, how did you do it? How was they when they are 7 or 8? What do you mean? Are you fasting? No, they started last year, Sheikh. What? Yeah, so it's, of course, so, you know, so what are you complaining from? Yeah, fasting is not a must on a child who did not reach puberty, 12, 13 year old, but you start before that. If you wait until they reach puberty, they are 13 year old now, and they never fasted. So they're gonna start. And starting with distractions, with hormones, with problems, with boys, you know, thinking about girls and girls thinking about boys, and the Facebook over there, and you know, Snapchats and all of these kind of things, and the public school and all of that, and then you tell them, fast. You are not gonna eat or drink until Maghrib. What? Even if they agree with you, they might sneak and do something, because they don't know what fasting is. You know, it's too much. Especially summer, especially when Ramadan now is in July, I mean May, it's gonna get cooler inshallah, but come on, right? So I remember the first month, the first Ramadan I fast, it was in July, and it was in Pakistan. Now, all the brothers from Pakistan know what I'm talking about, right? And homes, there was no AC. You're getting the idea here, right? So sometimes to cool yourself, you just go put some water on your clothes as it is, and you go walk outside, few minutes you'll dry up. Yeah, some people they do it on the street, you know, there are some tabs or something like that, and you find someone under the water like this. And then they walk 5-6 minutes to the masjid, they're dry already. MashaAllah, it's like car wash kind of business, you know? So this was like that. I remember when I started, 7-8 years old, and I started fasting like the whole thing. Before it was in your time, you know, you can, whenever you're tired, you eat, that's how it starts, right? Fast, and whenever you're tired, they let you eat. Okay, then after that, if you fast until like Zuhr, you get this, fast until Asr, Maghrib, then only in the weekend, so it goes like that, right? So 2-3 years, you're good, you're doing the whole thing. Now when I was that, doing the whole thing, it was very, very hard. And I'm telling you, I was very tempted many, many times just to drink water. And you're alone, nobody's watching, right? But subhanAllah, the maximum you can do, just put your head under the water to cool down. And you are wishing that some water comes in your lips, you know, like that. Children, you know, I'm just telling you, a child, you know, like if you do that when you are not mukallaf, it's all right. You know, you're doing this until you develop. Mukallaf means duty, and a person who have the duty. So when this is part of the training, okay? When you would rather have your children do that until it grows, the sense of responsibility grows with them and they appreciate. But you start everything later, No guarantee. And always fasting will become an issue and a challenge, even the person is 40 years old, subhanAllah. There are people who have that issue, and the wives complain, you know, what is the hukum if my husband does not fast? Do I cook for him or not? That's a fatwa, su'al, by the way. Yeah, you're wondering, but there are people like that. You know, my husband is, yeah, he prays and everything, but he can't fast. His parents did not teach him. So now we have to deal with two issues, right? One, how to get him to fast. And two, is she sinful if she helps him to eat or not? Yeah, welcome to Imam's lives. So the person who is sick but temporary, so they break the fast, but they have to make up. Person who's traveling, they can break fast, and they have to make up. A woman in her period, they doesn't eat. She is a must on her not to eat. Yeah, the musafir have the choice, right? You can fast when you are traveling. Your sickness does not affect you if you fast. You can fast if you want, but you can break fast if you want. You know, so it's up to you. But the woman in her period, she doesn't have that choice. She becomes sinful if she fasts, right? Then she makes up the fasting, but does not make up the salah, as Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned. Inshallah, we will stop here, and the next time we'll talk about the Hajj, بإذن الله تعالى. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all among those who fulfill the duties and who listen and follow the best of what they listen to. صلى الله على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. تفضل.
ابن السبيل.
نعم. ابن السبيل is the one who is traveling out of their home, out of their place, and they don't have the means to survive, or they don't have the means to go back to their place. So somebody like lost, or you know, they need money to travel back to their city, or whatever reason. So you can give them from zakah.
He's a newcomer to US, and then he's for a longer time he's jobless and things.
So yeah, actually more than one category will apply on that person. He is out of his place and he does not have money. Does he want to go back, or does he want to find a job? If he finds a job, that means he is a person who is in need, faqir and miskeen. If he borrowed some money and he needs to pay it back, that's his gharimin, and he is from the people in debt. So as I said, Ibn Sabil will apply, faqir will apply, miskin will apply, and the gharimin will apply. So that person who just came to the US and he does not have enough. But those they have over there, and they that's another issue too. Some people that are very rich over there, and they come here and they don't have a job. No, if they can survive on their own, bring the money from over there, buddy. So, yeah. Uncle Sam will love it. Uncle Sam Silver, yeah. Okay. Go ahead.
If you are, they say if you're 40 miles away, mm-hmm. you can pray a Qasr.
14?
40, 40.
Is it 14 miles, 40 miles or 40 kilometers? 40 miles, miles, yeah. You're right. Yeah.
But now suppose I'm going to Sugarland. Mm. That's more than 40.
That is the...
Is this still in Houston?
Ahsant, very good question. It's a very common textbook question. That's why the ulama said the Qasr is not only by the 40 miles. 40 miles out of what is considered your limits of your city. Oh. Yeah. So 40 miles from Lake City. Yeah. Right? And 40 miles from Woodlands, that way. And 40 miles from Baytown, that side, and 40 miles from Katy Masjid. So you go 40 miles out of that, 40 miles out of here, 40 miles after Masjid Maryam, 40 miles after Lake City, like that, yeah. Now.
Sheikh, if you decide to fast while you're traveling, mm. can you still combine your prayers and shorten your prayers?
Ahsant, very good question, yes. This one hukm and this is another hukm. So if you traveling, you want to do the qasr and the jam'a, continue doing that, but you want to fast, that's fine. So this is not connected to that. It does not mean that if you are fasting, you have to do the salah regular, and if you're not fasting, you shorten the salah. So two different things. That's one. The other thing, I'm sure you heard Sheikh Salah last time and the time before, he says jam'a, the issue of jam'a is much, much easier than the issue of the qasr, right? So a person can make qasr but don't have to do jam'ah. You know, you do jam'ah if you are afraid that you are not going to have time to. So if a person knows that they can pray on each salah time, they can choose to pray zuhr, two rak'ah on zuhr time. Don't gather asr with it. And wait until asr time comes, you pray two rak'ah. Maghrib time comes, you pray three rak'ah. Isha time comes, you pray two rak'ah, like that. So qasr is one issue. Gathering is another issue. Fasting is the third issue. So, yeah, you can do it. Now,
two questions.
Fadda.
First one, has Amjad concluded or agreed that donating to the masajid is part of the zakah has been
accepted? Yes. Yes, yes, it is. And giving to Islamic schools, to Islamic universities, sponsoring students, and the money is paid to the teachers and all of that, yes. You can give the money, zakah, to institutions.
Sheikh, could you please, simply, I'm 47 or 8 years old, I still don't get the understanding of madara alayhi al-hawl, that the 1 year has elapsed on the amount which is due. My question is, I sell a property today, I get $100,000, and I usually pay zakah in January. Do I pay on that $100,000
yes.
zakah today, or I wait till
no.
January?
No. Al-hawl, so the rule of the thumb. Rule of the thumb, you know. حول المال حول نصابه. حول المال حول نصابه. يعني the 1 year for all the money is the 1 year for the minimum. So the you are calculating 1 year for the minimum zakatable line. Anything more than that, it doesn't matter which day of the year it came to you. Even 5 minutes before the time, you're still gonna give zakat on that as if it has been there for 1 year because the minimum has been there for 1 year. Okay? Otherwise, you know, if person come getting lots of money every day, so 1 year and 1 year and 1 year, you're going to end up paying every day of the other year, you know? So it doesn't work like that. So the whole thing is you got 58 grams of gold and 595 grams of silver. You had those and they stayed for one whole year, you give 2.5%. Now, what if I started with the 595 of silver, equally any money, and then 1 day before the hawl comes, I got $1 million. You're gonna pay on $1 million all that. Even if it's the same day you're gonna give, right? You're gonna give on that. You don't say, oh, $1 million, you know, oh, yeah, I stayed only this much, and then now this $1 million, I'm gonna wait for one more year. No, you give on that year for everything that you. Why? Because you can start with $1 million, but 1 day before it went under, you don't pay zakat for that year, even though you had the whole zakatable money for a whole year. But it, so it goes fair, yani, both ways, inshallah. I hope it is understood within that context. Ma'am? Yes, ahsant. That's a very good idea. Why? Because sometimes we get confused, like, you know, when is the due time, right? So that's why we go according to Hijri, of course, for the fasting, for the Hajj, for our zakah calculation. So we go according to the Hijri time, not solar time. Okay, so Hijri time is the Hawl. So Hawl here, because if you calculate with the other calendar, it will become longer. It will become longer, right? 13 days, I think. Yeah, more. So then it's an issue. But when you do it in within the lunar calendar, the hawl is lesser. That means poor people will get faster, and you have to give earlier. Most of the people, they said, okay, beginning of Ramadan or during the month of Ramadan, I'm going to give. So it becomes better that way to remember and put it in your calendar. Yes.
I have a question about giving zakat to a recipient. Can you make giving the zakat to someone who is eligible, can you make it conditional? Let's say, for instance, the person has a bad habit or he has poor financial skills. Can you make it conditional that, look, if you give up this bad habit, I'll give you the zakat, or if you take a class in financial counseling, then I'll give you the zakat? From an organizational point of view, not necessarily an individual.
I understand. Well, the concept of making condition regardless, يعني making a condition, this for that is not there. So it should not be there, you know. Like somebody receiving zakah, they got to give the zakah. Now if they gonna play with it or not, this is their responsibility in front of Allah, and it's your responsibility to make sure that the person receiving zakah deserves it. So they are both accounted for that. But to make a condition that you have to do such and such, or you have to attend that class, or attend that, Allah alam, and I think there is an issue with that. But we can talk with our scholars about it and see. And no, but I can tell you yes or no.
How does a salaried person calculate zakah?
So now it's fiqh zakah now, right? How about we make a workshop about zakah? You agree? Everybody? Agreed? Yes? All right, so it's gonna go in the calendar, inshallah. Actually, I have it in the calendar for 2017, financial, you know, management and all that, and we'll get, you know, a couple of scholars to give workshops in this masjid, inshallah. But we will announce the date soon.
Who is eligible for zakat from family members?
طب تحبوا الزكاة انتوا اغنياء كلكم ما شاء الله يعني everybody. Anybody who's not, it's not a duty on you to spend on them. Then they can take the zakah. Yani a husband cannot pay his wife from zakah, but the other one is true. The wife can pay her husband from zakah. So if the wife has business, mashallah, and or she inherited money from her dad or her mom, okay, it's not a duty on her to spend on the house from it. This is her own money. See, sisters like that. They love it when I say those kind of things, right? But they don't like it when I said, you know, you give the zakah and your husband is out of a job or something, pay him the zakah. Give him the zakah money. But not the other way around. Because it's the duty on the husband to spend on his wife. And there's hadith of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. His wife Zainab came to ask Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, who is that? He said, Zainab. He said, Ayyu Zainab. Which Zainab, yani? Oof. There is Zainab, his wife. There is Zainab, his daughter. There is Zainab. So which Zainab? They said the wife of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, she came and asked him and said, Ya Rasulullah, I have wealth and my zakah is due, and Abdullah told me to give it to him. And I told him no. He said yes. So I said, okay, I'll ask Rasulullah. He said, go ask him. So she came and asked him. He said, yes, he's right. Give it to him. So yeah, if parents are living with you, it's a duty on you to spend on them so you don't give them zakah. But if your brother is in need, your nephew is in need, your sister is in need, yeah, you give them from your zakah. Now,
Faddish. And what age the kids should be trained for fasting?
Now, very good question. Taman, there are various conditions, and Dr. Hasib here can tell us, mashallah. Children have different abilities. So sometimes you have a 7-year-old who can start, sometimes 9-year-old can start. So based on their physical ability, you talk to their doctor if they can, you know, fast or not. There are children who can pass out, you know, like you don't want to do that. So first you have to know the health conditions of the child. Number two, you take it gradual. You don't just, you know. And also there are etiquettes. Some parents, they are very aggressive in this matter, and they become very mad at their children if they eat or something like that. And the child gets that. So they kind of feel that harsh, you know, it's harsh, I have to do it. It's not good. So morally, socially, psychologically, you have to be really, really, really careful. And you have to help and support your children and introduce it to them as something nice, something good. Okay? In the beginning, without them knowing. Like, you know, a father cooks or a mother cooks breakfast to their children, right? So Ramadan, you don't cook the breakfast. Let them ask for it. Dad, Mom, I'm hungry. Where is the breakfast? Here you go. Okay? Then later on, you delay it a little bit and a little bit. So they fast a few hours. And you say, in the weekend, inshallah, I'm going to have a prize for those who fast like that. So you train children. So I think 7 is a good time to start, you know. 7 years was the salah. Yeah, it was the salah time. So you're teaching them the deen, salah, and you teach them fasting as well. Either one is not obligated, right, on them until they reach puberty. But if you start from 7, you have about 6 to 7 years of training, which they will master it, inshallah, both. Yani. Both, they will be very good. Like by 10, they will pray good. And by 12 or 13, they have full Ramadans. They already fasted 3-4 full Ramadans already before it is obligated on them. So when it's obligated, they don't see the difference, right? They're already fasting. I always tell people, because of the school, start training your kids, as I said, like in the weekend, half day, then full weekends. Then after that, you know, later breakfast, half day of the regular days. Then, you know, full day of regular days, and let them skip if they are not able based on, you know, whatever. And then after that, you make, once they reach like 10 years old, then fasting, you have to really watch for it, right? You have to really make sure that they are fasting and you're supporting them and helping them and they're enjoying the iftar. They are, you know, part of it. So by 12 and 13, mashallah, they are on autopilot, okay, already. طيب سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك اللهم إنا نسألك خير هذا اليوم وخير ما فيه فتحه ونصره ونوره وبركته وهداه نعوذ بك من شره وشر ما فيه صل اللهم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والحمد لله رب العالمين.